Okay? Alright, so this is abstract, and here finally I decide what I will talk from now on until the end of this lecture. And so this is the up to three that we passed by, and then this is fourth one. So I will talk about looking at the universe through different glasses. And then from fifth to eighth, ninth, this is tentative idea what I will talk from now on. But of course, we can change without any kind of information, but with, you know, some warning or anything like that. So in here, I try to put three links. One is slide, so you can either download the slide in PDF format. That was a mistake. The file is very large, so so you can download the slide that we talked in a previous lecture, and the handout is also linked. And then here, etc. is actually the list of my homework that I would try to fill out. So this is the question that I could not answer properly or didn't have enough time to answer in detail during the lecture time. And I tried to fill out the information in here. For example, here, the first lecture I remember, some person, I can remember exactly who did that, who asked this question, but he asked like, what is the flux when I talk about the constant rate flux? So I will try to describe more details about what is the constant rate flux and why we use that kind of unit for specific unit for the constant rate flux. So this is still empty, definitely not filled it up yet. But at least I finished just the previous homework, because when you finish undone homework, you go from the previous one and go a little bit farther from there. So in here, I tried to answer some of the questions that you asked, like previous lecture. One was, how does the solar magnetic polarity change? If we talk about the solar magnetic polarity change in 22 years of period, but the question was, is it changing abruptly, like in one moment, or slowly changing? So this is the answer that I tried to find out in the books and stuff. And what kind of thing is making the geomagnetic field, or so this is the answer. And so I linked some web page that will link to this nice web page that you can write down the zip code, link to smart altitude, elevation, and then the date, and they will give you the magnetic field in that location. So just for fun. So that is the web page, and I hope that you enjoy. Sorry that it took a long time for me to prepare that one. So again, this is the address. Yes?
Can you turn down the lights?
Look at the handout and find out the web page address. So today we will talk about the other messenger from the universe. So I try to describe in a more friendly way by saying looking at the universe through different glasses, because up to now we try to look at the universe in the glass which is named as cosmic rays. But definitely, cosmic ray is not the only thing which is coming from the universe. So there's a lot other information that we can get from the universe, which eventually will help us to understand what's going on in the universe and galaxies and stars and all those kind of beautiful stuff. So in here, in this lecture, we will be away from cosmic ray just for a while and try to use the other glasses, which is different from the cosmic rays. But at the end of the lecture, I will try to make a connection between these different glasses with our previous glasses, which is cosmic ray, and why I made this kind of, you know, get away from the cosmic ray topic thing. So, as usual, we will talk first about the previous lecture. So, previous lecture, we try to understand our environment in cosmic ray's point of view. So, in cosmic rays point of view, when it comes from somewhere in the galaxy to the Earth, what kind of thing, environment condition that is going through? We want to talk about this because to understand the constant rate that we are measuring at the Earth, we need to understand what kind of bias that is inside the data. For example, are we looking at real original constant rate, or some amount of information that we are looking at in the Earth is altered because it goes through some kind of interaction or changes in the environmental condition to the Earth and then the solar system and the galaxies. So, to understanding that is really important. If we really want to understand what's going on the source side of cosmic rays. So, just that there's a lot of things that we need to learn to understand the original information from the cosmic ray. But I tried summarizing just the two big items. One is material, and the other is magnetic field. Because cosmic rays are charged particles, so it cannot go through the magnetic field without changing its direction. So whenever cosmic wave go into the magnetic field, it will bend inside the magnetic field. So knowing the magnetic field is very important, and really, really important to understand the cosmic waves. And also, whenever cosmic wave go into the matter, then it will lose its energy by several different kind of processes that we talked during the lecture too. So knowing about how many of material is located between us to the cosmic ray source site is also very important to understand about the cosmic rays. So in here, I also briefly categorize about our environment in three different categories. One is the Earth. So we talk about the geomagnetic field in the Earth, and which is actually protecting us from the particles coming from the solar sun. And also we talk about the material in the atmosphere, which is also protecting us from the high energy cosmic ray, because all the high energy cosmic ray we eventually destroy and lose all of its energy inside the atmosphere, because there's a lot of material in the gases, nitrogen, oxygen in the atmosphere. And in the solar system, there's a solar wind we talk about, and we talk about the strength of the solar wind, how it is connected to the cosmic ray, because it actually gives some kind of boundary in the solar system. So when there's a lot of solar wind, strong solar wind is surrounding the solar system, then low energy cosmic ray cannot come into the solar system. And when there's a solar wind is really small activity, then low energy cosmic ray can actually penetrate and come into the solar system. So we talk about that. In our galaxy, our galaxy also has a magnetic field, and it also has a material. I mean, compared to atmosphere, it's very, 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 very small amount. But it also has a really, really large distance, so we need to think about the total amount of material that cosmic rays need to go through to arrive at the Earth. So that's what we talked in the previous lecture. And this lecture, we will talk about the different glasses. So I already spoiled the answer for my quiz that I will show in the next page. So we will talk about electromagnetic radiation. Really small part of electromagnetic radiation is actually very well known, as named as light, which we are using right now to actually detect your shape in my brain. And that all sort of visual light is also a part of electromagnetic radiation. So I will briefly mention about what is electromagnetic radiation, and then it's kind of going to follow the exact step that we followed for the cosmic ray. So I will talk about the interaction of electromagnetic radiation, and then finally I will try to talk why I want to talk about electromagnetic radiation in the middle of lecture series about the cosmic rays. So that's the thing. So here goes the piece. All right. So. Page number one, what is the similarity in these pictures? So you can see different picture. This one looks more familiar than the other picture, I assume. This one's a human, if you didn't realize. So, and this is hand, and this is sun. So this, what is the similarity of this? I know this kind of question is maybe hard to get answered from the people sitting on the audience, because I did not know. Alright. Okay. So, any brave soul who You can answer the question. I will give you the answer. So you can. Yes.
Visible. Ultraviolet.
Yes. So this is infrared image and visible light of beautiful Chicago landscape, and it's X-ray image, and this is ultraviolet image. So all of these, the similarity between these four pictures is all of them are belong to electromagnetic radiation. So that was the similarity, and I know that the second question is much easier to get answered from you. So some of pictures are in here are fabricated, and some of pictures are not fabricated in here. So how many old pictures in this four picture do you think is not fabricated? So it's original as it is. So if you think it's a one, raise your hand. So you think like three or four pictures is fabricated and this one picture is not fabricated.
What do you mean fabricated?
Yeah. It's not real. It's not real. Fake picture in a way.
Not real?
Yes. Somehow it is fake. So some of the picture in here is fake picture. So how many pictures do you think is not fake? So, okay, I will just ask the question. So, you think one picture out of four is not fabricated? Raise your hand. Okay, two are not fabricated. Okay, alright. And three are not fabricated. Okay, all of them are not fabricated. Alright, okay, the answer is actually one.
Yeah.
So the only picture which is not fake or fabricated in this four picture is visible light. Because all of the other picture is fabricated in a way that we can actually see the picture. Because we cannot see ultraviolet, we cannot see infrared, and we cannot see the X-ray. So we had to come up with some idea how to get the information from something that why is shaking. What's actually going on in the sun, for example, in ultraviolet image. And when scientists do that, we try to be a little bit more tricky so you will not actually realize that what you are seeing here is actually not being seen in your eyes. For example, when people try to make this picture, they tend to use bluish color for the ultraviolet image and try to use reddish color for the infrared image. So that's why you think it's not fake. But actually, all of these are fake image, so, and the X-ray image as well. So that was one thing that we always need to remember. The only thing that human eyes can see is visible light in here.
Okay.
Yes, I realize it.
Did we have a small earthquake or something?
I wonder. Okay, maybe it will be gone for time. Okay, let's give it like 5 minutes before I restart my computer. I think it's connection, but sometimes I think it takes some time to answer.
Some building coming in, dancing, door.
Alright. I hope that they finish their work as soon as possible. Okay, so that was the third piece. So electromagnetic radiation, sorry that it's also like too much. I don't see any kind of wave in the screen. I don't know anything. So I think it's connection. Wide range of energy. So I am cosmic ray physicist. So for me, the most convenient unit is electron volt, which we always use in the cosmic ray. If you remember the spectrum that I always showed you, it covers from 10 to the 9 electron volt up to 10 to the 21 electron volt. In here, the energy. range of electromagnetic radiation covers from 10 to the minus 9 electron volt up to the 10 to the 6 electron volt, and actually goes higher than that. So it covers like really, really, so if you write down the number in non-scientific way, like 15 or 16 joule will follow from one number. That is the amount of range that electromagnetic radiation is covering. And of course, as you can imagine, it has various different kind of property, depends on what is the energy of that electromagnetic radiation. And because electromagnetic radiation was much easier to detect or measure compared to Cushing wave, because we can see that. So we can see the visible light, and we can play with visible light, putting some lens there, or putting some prism there, or you know, playing with the mirror, reflecting, and all sorts of stuff like that. So it was much faster to find out some part of each region, and because of that, it has different name. That's, I think, why. So from the low energy part, the low energy of electromagnetic radiation is well known as radio. So when you turn on the radio, or if I turn on my handphone, then that will actually get, it has antenna inside the iPhone, for example, and catch the signal in this range of energy of electromagnetic radiation. And also we know the microwave, which some of you may have in my house. I didn't have, but my new apartment finally had microwave. So it is actually heating the water vapor inside the food, so that's how it heats the food. And if energy was higher, like 1,000 times higher than the energy of electromagnetic radiation of microwave, then we call it as infrared, and it's very closely related with the heat. So if there is some object which can emit some heat, then that means that object is actually emitting in the energy range of this one, and then you will be able to see whether there's a human being there or not. Okay, like this picture. Actually, in x-axis in here, it's really hard to see, but it's actually temperature. So as temperature goes higher and higher, you will see different energy of the electromagnetic radiation. So that's how you can actually figure it out, which one has a higher temperature compared to the other one. And the visible light, you know it very well. And the energy of visible light is about electron volt. So if I compare with this one and the radio, then the visible light is like 10 to the 9 times the higher energy compared to radio. And also if I compare this visible light to the energy coming from the sun, most particle coming from the sun, which is about several hundred keV, then that particle usually have like 10 to the 5 times higher energy compared to visible light. And ultraviolet is a higher energy than visible light, so it goes up to X-rays and then gamma rays. So these all different main categories actually belong to the same family, which is named as electromagnetic radiation. And there's a lot of information here which I will try to skip because it's too many of them. But one thing that I wanted to mention is there is a temperature which is prepared by an object which there's a temperature with, for example, if the sun is emitting some radiation light, for example, then there's a prepared radiation because the black body radiation. So for example, sun's temperature is about this much, 6,000 Kelvin, and if the surface temperature is about 6,000 Kelvin, then usually the mean average light is coming in this range of energy. So meaning that if sun, because of its temperature is about this much, so when it emits a radiation, most of the radiation of that coming from the sun is in the energy range of around here, which is visible light. That's why we can see sun, and there's always white light coming from the sun. So that's one. And then the other thing I want to mention here is in the main sequence star, if the star's mass is 25 times higher than solar mass, then the surface temperature is about this much. But still, this range is almost about the visible light to the ultraviolet light. So what I want to say in here by pointing out these two factors is there's a lot more energy range in the electromagnetic radiation, even this main sequence star, which is 25 times massive than the solar mass, cannot produce by thermal, their thermal activity. So for example, it cannot generate, I mean, some of them actually can generate in X-rays, but most of them are in the visible light or ultraviolet light. So there's more of this, more of some kind of mechanism which can produce X-rays or gamma rays. And then I really want to emphasize about X-rays and gamma rays because they will have a really close relationship with the quantum rays that I want to talk about. So in here, up to here, you can imagine some kind of like reflection and, what is the word? Absorption and emission kind of related thing that you can easily imagine by, for example, looking at the mirror, you are looking at your image because of the reflection of the light. So that is part of this visible light and below. But as it goes higher and higher, it can actually start to be able to penetrate the material. For example, you can see your hand in X-ray, in like this. This is a picture from the X-ray. And actually what it does is actually has a film and they will shoot the X-ray on your hand. Then what happens is some of the X-ray, for example in the skin depth, they will just penetrate like there's nothing there. So that's why you are seeing much fainter image in here, because it will penetrate just without any problem. But bone is much denser compared to your skin or compared to your body. So the more X-ray may not be able to penetrate the bone. That's why, so it's almost like shadowing effect. So if it is just a visible light, then what you will see is some shadow like this. Because there's a matter here, visible light cannot penetrate my skin. But X-ray can penetrate almost all of my skin except my bone, because bone is much denser. I actually don't know how bone is actually look like, but something like that, I guess. Yeah, okay. So that's why you can actually see the shape of bone or shape of something that you hide inside your body or something like that. So that's why it's much easier to detect the metallic thing in the X-ray, because matter is much denser compared to your body. So if you have matter and go through X-ray detector in the airport, for example, it's likely that matter with the X-ray that they are using cannot penetrate that matter plate. So that will be show up in the screen like some material here. So X-ray has more penetration power compared to visible light, and gamma ray has much more penetration compared to X-ray. And so we will talk about what kind of process can explain that, or what kind of thing we actually know about the interaction. So in here, I will talk about the interaction of electromagnetic radiation, and I just use this tool later because I'm lazy and it's a little long work to use. So there's like three main processes that we will talk about. But again, there's a lot of processes that we can talk about the electromagnetic radiation, but these three processes are the most important part when it comes to the really high energy gammas, which is X-rays and gamma rays. So we will talk about photoelectric effect and compton scattering and ampere production. But if you compare with what we talk about the charged particle, which is mostly we talk about this interaction of charged particle to understand about the interaction of quantum wave with matters, and well, it's much shorter, so hopefully we will go through this process very quickly. And also I want to show these processes because to show you about the connection between the charged particle interaction with the electromagnetic radiation, which in result that in conclusion that I will talk why I want to talk about this. Because in these processes that we talked during the lecture too, there is a process which will be connected to the gamma rays or X-rays or light. For example, from top to bottom, Cherenkov light is when charged particles come into the matter and travels faster than the speed of light in the material, and it will emit some light. Key point here is it is emitting light. which is part of electromagnetic radiation. So if you want to understand about the chunk of light, or if you want to detect the chunk of light, then you also need to understand about the, some property of the light. But this is usually, we are talking about the visible light, so it's more like a little bit different kind of family. And we talk about the Brown cell, which is when the charged particle come into the nucleus, then it will be dissolved because of electric field. So because of that, then we emit the radiation. And that radiation can be very, very high energy. Depends on the energy of instant charged particle. So it will, this process, when charged particle come into the material, then it will go through this process, and that process will emit some light. And to understand what will happen after that, we need to understand what is the interaction for all the light. So that is another thing which is connecting between the charged particle and electromagnetic radiation. And there is interaction with specific conditions, and all of those are actually connected to the electromagnetic radiation. So for example, all the process in here, which has a name, is radiation, means that it will emit some kind of radiation. So to understand what will happen eventually after it goes through all these processes, then you need to understand both of cases to have a full picture about the interaction chains. So that's why I want to talk about, I already kind of spoiled, but that's one of the reasons why I wanted to talk about the electromagnetic radiation today. So first of all, photoelectric effect. So it is when it's most likely X-rays. So when X-rays come into the material, and then it will lose all of its energy and give it to some kind of electron in some location in this energy band. And what will happen is the gamma will disappear, and the electron which get the energy from the gamma is become energetic enough so it can actually get away from the atom. So it will eject it from the atom. And depends on the energy of gamma, the speed of this ejection will be changing. So for example, if the energy of gamma is really, really, really small, then it will not go that farther and maybe be absorbed by the other atom in the material. But for example, if the gamma ray, the energy is really, really high, then it can actually go farther and then actually lose its energy by ionization loss and something like that. And the Compton scattering, which is named after Compton, obviously. And so that's when incoming gamma ray photon is deflected through an angle. So this gamma ray coming from this direction and transfer some amount of energy and lose some amount of energy by itself and go in the other direction. And this electron gets enough energy so it can actually move from the atom and travel away. And so it transfers the portion of gamma ray's energy. So because of that, gamma ray will be losing its energy. And I try to put that in by looking at this wavelength. So if the wavelength of gamma ray is shorter, then means it's a higher. So it loses its energy by this interaction. And some amount of that energy go to electron, and then the electron is emitted from the atom. So that is Compton scattering. So by looking at this interaction, you can actually see two things. One is the energy is transferred from the photon to the electrons. So electron was freed from the atom and it will emit it in some direction. And the other thing that you can actually see here is the directional change. So gamma ray was initially wanted to go in that direction, but because it went through this interaction, it will change its direction. And the directional change between this gamma and electron actually is very well summarized in a very simple mathematical way. So if you know, because the energy and momentum had to be conserved before the interaction and after the interaction. So if you know exact angle and exact energy of both photon and electrons, then you can actually estimate what was the initial condition for the gamma ray. So that was Compton scattering. And the pair production is when the gamma rays, incident gamma rays energy is higher then the rest mass of energy of some particle, usually the electron was the case, then it can actually disappear when and they create a pair of particle and antiparticle. So for example, we know that the rest mass energy of electron is 0.511 MeV, it's 10 to the 6th electron volt. So ruthenium, and then when the gamma ray's energy is higher than this one, actually multiply by 2 because it needs to create pair. So in that case, the gamma ray, if the minimum gamma ray energy is higher than 1, above 1 MeV, then it can create positron and electron pair. And if the energy is much higher than 1 MeV, what will happen is it will create this pair, but the paired positron and electron will be more energetic, and then it can go farther in the material. So that is the pair production. And actually, it is, in a way, reverse the process of annihilation that we taught in the lecture too. Annihilation was when particle and an antiparticle meets, then it disappeared and create two gammas, and this one is in a way reversed. So that was the pair production, and that is three main process that X-ray and gamma rays go through. So in here, this would be one and last graph in this lecture. So let's try to understand this picture. So this is the try to actually plot what's the probability of this interaction happening inside the material. So attenuation coefficient gamma is, so for this sodium iodide, when the gamma with the specific energy in here from 0.01 MeV up to 10 MeV gamma is go into this sodium iodide, which look like this, crystallized, then how much of photon will lose its energy? How much photon will go through without any interaction? So what is the probability of having this interaction is the one that is summarized in this graph. So the total probability can be summarized in this way. So this is sphere reversed, so let's assume that if the gamma or specific energy from here to here is trying to penetrate 1 centimeter thickness of sodium iodide. Okay? So 10 means that about this much of initial, this much of photon will survive after 1 centimeter, meaning that almost all the photon will not be able to survive. It will be all disappeared because of interaction. So that is 10 line. And one line in here is about 37% of initial intensity will survive. So for example, if we shoot like 100 of photon in 1 centimeter of sodium iodide, then only 37 will survive after 1 centimeter. And this line, 0.1, that means 90% of initial intensity will survive after 1 centimeter. So if you shoot 100 photon in 1 centimeter, then you will have 90 photons after 1 centimeter. So that means, so as it goes higher and higher, there will be less and less interaction. So that was the y-axis, and let's try to combine the information from x-axis and y-axis. So in this particular material, when x-ray comes in, when 10 kV x-ray comes in, then so 10 kV, so that's like 10,000 the higher energy than visible light energy. When it comes in, then it's about 500, meaning that almost everything will be disappeared. So this thick line is total probability of interaction happening because of all these interactions that we talk about. So so this thick line is the total probability, and we can divide in the three different categories as we talk about the interaction. So first of all, this is a line of probability to have a photoelectric effect that we just talked about. And this is a line for the compton scattering, and this is a line for the pair production. So in the low energy particle, like 10 kV, photon when it, I'm sorry, I should not say particle, 10 kV when it comes to the matter in this particular matter, then almost all the thing will be disappeared. And we can actually try to calculate how many are, what percentage of the interaction actually made that thing happen. And we can actually see photoelectric effect was dominant process for that one. And it goes in that way continuously because we have limited time and we skip this specific characteristic peak there. And as energy goes in higher and higher, then the influence of photoelectric effect is decreasing as this red line go down. So about 500 kV, now almost the dominant effect is Compton scattering. And actually you can imagine what will happen is just by definition, photoelectric effect is the photon need to be completely absorbed in the atom, the electron in the atom. So as it goes in higher and higher, it will be much harder for the energy level difference inside the atom to absorb entire energy from the photon. So it will go, now the Compton scattering will be dominant more, and as energy goes higher, and now the pair production will start to begin. So after 10 MeV or so, it will start to be lighting like that. So that is the kind of idea that you need to, well, it's better, it would be helpful if you can have it in your mind. And then further about here, we can also consider about how penetrating these X-rays and gamma rays. Because, for example, in the 1 MeV, already combination of the pair, combination of photoelectric effect and then Compton scattering, the summation is still like about this much, meaning that about 90% of the initial intensity of photon will survive after 1 cm. So compared to this energy range, the photon with this energy has much higher penetrating power. So it will be able to survive without any kind of suffering from the interaction. So that was a thing that we want to know. So in here, I try to make it a little bit easy diagram to describe about the interaction with the matter. So this one you already saw many of times. So it's when charged particles come into the material, and this is for the low energy particles. So it will be scattered around the molecular or atoms, and then it will lose its energy and eventually lose all of its energy by ionization. So it will ionizing the material. And if it is a high energy, it can penetrate but lose its some amount of its energy by ionization loss. And we talk about this, and when the energy is higher, then it will lose actually lose less energy. So that is about interaction in charged particle. So let's review what you learned today about the gamma ray. So for the low energy gamma ray, what will happen is it will stop because of photoelectric effect. And then it will kick up one electron in atom, and that atom will move from the original site and then away from the atom because it has enough energy to get away from its nucleus. Then it will lose its energy by ionization like this one because it's charged the particle electron. So eventually it will stop and lose when it loses all of its energy. So that's the diagram for that one. And we know that most of the high energy gamma ray, we just penetrate the matter like it never sees that. But some of them will go through, if it is higher energy than this one, then it will go through another, a little bit more complicated process. So what will happen is gamma ray comes in and kicks in some kind of electron in here, but it didn't give all its energy to that electron. So it actually loses its energy but has enough of energy, so it will go in and maybe meet another electron, and then it will lose all of its energy to that electron and stop there. But there will be two electrons generated by this interaction, and that will go through in the matter and lose all of its energy by ionization loss. So that is mostly for the photon, which is a higher energy than this one. Then what will happen if it goes much higher energy than this one? Then what will happen is it will make a pair again. That was a little bit complicated. Okay, so let's try it. I cannot slow it down. So what will happen is when gamma comes in, it will make a positron and electron pair. So the electron is traveling this way and moves until it loses all of its energy by ionization. But positron, because there's a lot of matter inside the material. Okay, that doesn't make sense. It wasn't actually English. But anyway, so positron will annihilate when it met with the particle inside, because there's a lot of electron inside the matter, right? So when positron tries to go away, propagate inside the material, then it will meet some electron and annihilate and generate the gamma rays. That's annihilation. And the gamma ray of that generation is going away and lose all of its energy by photoelectric effect and give all of its energy to the electron bound in the atom. And that electron will be coming out from the atom and move until it loses all of its energy. So that is chain of interaction. So to understand all of this one, then you need to actually really know, okay, I hope that I could go a little bit just one way. So to understand the full interaction, you already now recognize that we need to understand both interaction for the charged particle and the gamma rays. Then what will happen to the material? Material really doesn't care whether it gets energy from the charged particle or gamma rays. It will just will get some energy from whatever gamma ray or charged particle. So this is the sodium iodide that we just talked about in the previous slide. And what will happen in this particular material is really nice material, which is used in the detector area, for the detector in many cases, because when it gets energy from this kind of interactions, then some of the its atom actually will be excited. And when it tries to come back to the ground station, it will emit some kind of light, so actually it will look like this. So this is the same crystal, and it's just sitting in front of X-ray emitter, so it's sitting in front of something which will generate X-ray continuously. So because of X-ray will lose all of its energy by going through this kind of mechanism, so the molecular inside this crystal will be excited, and when it try to be going into ground stage, then you will emit some kind of light, which is bluish light that you can see by your eye. Because it's emitting a light in a visible light kind of range, so actually you can see it. And if you have a really, really sensitive detector which can count how many photons was generated, then you can actually measure what happened in the material. Yes?
Would it get warmer too? Would it get hot? Would it get warmer too? Some of the energy would be transforming to.
Yes, but it's more like a vibration inside the molecular, so I don't think you can actually feel the heat by your hand.
No, I mean that, but it would be some of the energy.
Yes.
Question?
Yes.
So if you had an infinitely thick piece of sodium and you shot gamma ray through it, at some point, I don't know what length it would be, would the gamma ray then mimic the same effect as an X-ray?
What was the last part of your sentence?
With eventually the gamma ray of high energy, it would lose some of its energy, and then it would maybe start to react against the sodium particles just like an X-ray, because as it goes through the thickness, it would lose some of the energy.
Yeah, if it is infinitely thickness
of
the material.
So it might then mimic the same effect as
is 0.5, and then in proton is 1 GeV, so it's almost 10 to the 4 times higher energy. So it's really, really generating proton in that way. But there's really, really low probability that it can generate other than positron and electron pair. But it's much more likely that you will lose its energy by generating electron and positron pair. Okay, so let's try to connect this all information with the cosmic ray. So as I talk up to now, I'm talking about electromagnetic radiation just because it will complete our picture about the chain of interaction that cosmic ray may go through. So that means that it will help us understand what will happen in our atmosphere, and also it will help us to design better detector to understand all this interaction, chain of interaction. So So that's one thing. And the bigger picture of that one is because the interaction is happening not only inside our detector or atmosphere, it is happening wherever there's a material or wherever there's a magnetic field. So meaning that when cosmic rays is created in a source site, then it goes through all these materials and magnetic field. And if we understand all these interactions, then we will have a better picture. And the good part of a gamma ray is it's not bending in a magnetic field. So it may give us another clue about the cosmic rays in that way. We will talk a little bit more about that one. So this is another picture that we saw in the lecture two. So this is interaction with the high energy cosmic ray when it comes to air. So in here, I try to say from the start, let's start with the light element, which is electron. When high energy electron comes to the atmosphere, then it will actually generate the gamma ray by Raman-Solomon process. So it will lose some of its energy by generating this radiation. But this electron itself can be very high energy. So it can actually do another process to lose its energy. So it actually generates another Raman-Solomon process. And so it loses its energy and generates another gammas. And the gamma, as we said before, will make a pair production. So it will make a positron and electron pair. What will happen is if all this secondary particle is still energetic enough, then it can actually create another kind of processes. So positron itself will lose its energy by Raman-Solomon because it's way too high energy to get losing all of its energy by annihilation. So it will generate another gamma in here. And this is another Raman-Solomon and another Raman-Solomon. And this gamma will generate these pairs of positron and electron. So it will go following like that until, for example, positron lose all of its energy by annihilation and make two gammas, and the electron will lose all of its energy by ionization. Then what will happen after this? The gamma will go through Compton scattering and eventually absorb in the electron in the atom and then completely disappear in the atmosphere. So that was electromagnetic shower that we talked about, and we also know that there will be Cherenkov light coming in and scintillation light coming in because of the nitrogen was excited and it would emit some light when it goes to the ground stage. And what will happen with a high energy gamma coming to the atmosphere? It will actually look very similar with this one. The difference is because the first coming in is gammas, so it will actually make a positron and an electron pair, the pair production that we talk about. Then if the gamma's energy is really high, then the secondary particle of electron and positron's energy is high enough so it can go through kind of similar process in this one. So this branch can be attached to this branch, like that. And this branch also, if I just change this one, the positron will be attached in here. So it goes through in this kind of interactions, and eventually this gamma will be removed by a photoelectric effect and the energy will be absorbed entirely in the alchemy. So that was the process. To understand full picture of this process, that we need to understand the Raman-Solomon pair production, annihilation, to be able to understand the creation of this secondary particle, and to be able to understand how the secondary particle loses all of its energy, we need to understand the Compton scattering and then photoelectric effect. So that was the electromagnetic shower. And the hadronic shower, what will happen is fairly similar thing. The only difference is because it's a proton or heavier than proton, so it will go through the nuclear interaction. So a high energy proton will destroy the atom or molecular, actually the atom, like nitrogen or oxygen inside the atmosphere, and then it will, because of this bombardment, this one will be completely broken and then make a light element, and like ion or that kind of element will be generated by these nuclear interactions. So another new thing happening here is because of this ion, there will be a lot of decaying mode is coming in, so pi zero will decay in two gammas, and we know what will happen when gamma with a high energy energy coming to the atmosphere. It's just happening again of the previous picture, just attached to here, then we have a complete picture of the interactions. And we didn't talk a lot about the pi minus and pi plus decay mode, but there's a decay of that things too. So that will be making hadronic showers. So hadronic shower is actually containing some part of the electromagnetic shower inside of their branch. So to understand whole picture of a hadronic shower, and remember, like 1 GeV, about 90% of cosmic rays are protons. So it's more essential for us to actually follow in these interactions to understand the cosmic rays. So that was to understand, to try to describe understanding the interactions of both electromagnetic radiation and cosmic rays are important to understand the processes happening in the air shower. But now we are trying to go back in the source site of cosmic rays. So let's assume there is a high energy cosmic ray in the space with a bunch of matters. So because it doesn't really look like matter, I just write down matter here. So what will happen is proton will meet some kind of assumed matter. If there's a matter, and we know that there's a high energy cosmic ray because we can measure it in the air, then what will happen is the same thing that we saw in the atmosphere will happen in here. So there will be nuclear interaction, and then pi zero will happen, and then we are talking about pi zero because it will emit gamma rays. And so pi zero will decay to the two gammas. One difference is in here is atmosphere is much denser compared to whatever existing in the space. So the gamma ray have better chance to survive in the long distance. So that will happen. And when electron comes in this matter, then it will emit another gamma rays and because of Gram-Salon process, and then we travel like that. So this kind of process will happen. So that thing is can be happened if there is a bunch of matter in the space. Okay, looks similar, but let's assume that this is magnetic field. So let's assume that there's a high energy cosmic ray in the space with a locally strong magnetic field. What will happen is, for example, electron, most of the time, electron will lose its energy by synchrotron radiation because of magnetic field, and it will emit some gamma ray as well. And another thing which can happen is when there's a photon field in the space, then the electron will lose its energy by inverse quantum scattering that we talked before. So electron will give its energy to the gammas in a low energy stage in this photon field, and the gamma will gain become a new high energy gamma and then travel in a way. So that was when we assume if there is some matter in the space or in the, some magnetic field in the space or some photon field in the space. And are these conditions really exist? The answer is yes. Okay. I tried to put a lot of picture in here just because this is a rare chance for me to give beautiful picture in this lecture. So we already measured some of magnetic field around the supernova remnant. Of course, we know that there's a magnetic field in the galaxy. So there is magnetic field in the galaxy. So the condition exists, the condition that we talked about before. And we talk about whether there's any kind of material in the space. Yes, we know that there's material in there. There's a gas, dust, and that kind of thing in the galaxy. And there's also locally populating the dense material in the galaxy as well. So these two pictures, the reason why these two is just because it's very good, is actually molecular picture of molecular cloud in the space. So you can see background light in here, but there's nothing, you cannot see something like continuous light here, continuous light. Like this reason it looks like a little bit different compared to the other reasons. It's because there's a material in our line of sight. So when there's a light coming in our point of view, when there's a material here, then the light may not go through this material, so it looks like it's much darker than the other side. It's kind of same thing for this horse head nebula as well. So we know that there is a dense material in the galaxy. We know that there is a material all over the galaxy, but we also know that there's a locally populating dense material, like molecular cloud that we talk. And the last one that we talked about was whether there is a photon field in the galaxy. And that's also yes. One of the quantum fields that you can think is starlight. Star is emitting the light, that is also kind of quantum-like quantum field, which can actually help to make an inverse quantum scattering, so high-energy electron can accelerate the photon, and then the photon will gain a lot of high energy and come to us. And also the most interesting.
How do you observe the magnetic field in a supernova remnant to make that first picture?
I am not really measuring this, but as far as I understand, you can actually measure the polarity of the signal, and based on that polarity, you can actually guess what is the magnetic field in that region. So that's why that's actually this small arrow is the direction of the field. So fortunately, we have all these conditions, so all the process that we talk about before will happen in the space, and we are seeing actually the result of that kind of processes. So are there any measured data about this? Yes, there is measured data, and in here, I tried to get one example out of a lot of examples in the field, and it's very exciting to talk about this because this is fairly recent kind of discoveries, because when we talk about the cosmic ray has been discovered like 99 years ago, but compared to that time, this one is a fairly new discovery, 2005, 2010, and well, it's a little bit, yeah. So this example is supernova 1006106. I actually don't know how to properly say in English the name. So this one is fairly popular supernova remnant because it was measured observed by a lot of people in the Earth. I think it was exploding like, I can't remember exact. I didn't really look down. Yeah, I didn't really look down. But it was exploding. So supernova is massive star, and when massive star exploded, then it will really, really emit a lot of bright light. So before we understand what's going on in there, then for us it looks like there's a new star happening, a really, really bright new star just appear in the dark sky. That's why we call it a supernova. And this one is especially famous in historical because it, I think, happened in like several 1,000 AD or something like that. So it was actually described a bit in history in China and in some other places in the world. So someone actually knew. There's a lot of supernova that we don't know when it exploded, but this is very few supernova, one of few supernova we actually know when it was exploded. So in here I tried to plot three different kind of picture. So does it look similar to you? So I was trying to say that it looks different, but actually it looks fairly similar. So this one is from the Chandra, and in here also all this picture, as you can imagine, is fake picture, so it does not really look like this in your eye. So in here, artificially, they try to put different color for different energy range. So red color for this energy range, and cyan color for this energy range, and blue color for the highest energy range in here. So this is one of the reasons why we are using fake color, because in that just kind of help us to visualize what's going on in here. So you can see a lot of reddish color in the center field, but also you can see a lot of more like bluish color at the edge of this shell, right? So we know that the red color inside here is making this kind of radiation energy because of the thermal radiation. But as energy goes in higher and higher, you can see it is much more like concentrating this region. And if you look at much higher energy than this one, then you can actually see it's more accentuated around this energy range. So in here, this color range is from blue to white from like this energy range. So as it goes yellow and white, meaning that that's more higher energy compared to blue, right? So meaning that there's much higher energy gamma ray coming from this edge region. And the reason why this happening that way, we know that But because there's a, we know that because it's exploded, and we know that there will be some strong stellar wind and magnetic field will be concentrated in this kind of region. And we know that if there's a magnetic field, then the cosmic ray can actually lose its energy by synchrotron radiation, as we talk about. That will generate the photon, which we are actually observing in 10 point. So that's why we are seeing here. And from here, it is 10 to the 3 electron volt. And when we go to much higher energy, which is 10 to the 9 electron volt to 10 to the 12 electron volt, meaning that this picture, you are seeing gamma coming from this supernova, which is millions times higher energy than the picture that you are seeing here. But still, you can see kind of similar shape. This white one is actually quantum that they got from here, this picture. So you are seeing much higher concentration of the high energy gamma coming from this region compared to the other region. So that is also same because that is happening because of inverse Compton scattering. So the high energy electron is scattering off the CMB background radiation and then generate the high energy photon, and we are measuring that. So all of this picture is actually showing the exact same thing that we talked about that before. So it actually, not only we have the condition, but we also have the evidence that it actually, the interaction that we talked for today's lecture is actually happening. So we just have two more slides to go. Sorry, I'm always late. So the electron, so we now know that understanding electromagnetic radiation can be very essential to understand the cosmic ray. Then we also want to know how electromagnetic radiation can come to the Earth. So again, this is the same slide that I showed last lecture. So we need to understand about our environment in this case, in the point of view of electromagnetic radiation. So actually, this list is just an exact copy of the list that I showed for the previous lecture. So this is the environment in the point of view of cosmic ray. Because we are dealing with electromagnetic radiation, we can remove safely some part of that because it's light. It just does not care about magnetic field at all. So it doesn't care about geomagnetic field. It doesn't care about solar wind. And it doesn't care about the, well, it's not cosmic ray sign, that's why I have to move that one. So it doesn't care about the magnetic field in our galaxy. It does care about the background light, the starlight, the microwave, background, and this kind of stuff. But the, we know that it will actually help for the electromagnetic radiation to gain some energy. So important in here is the gamma can point to the source. So, for example, when there's some high energy, oh, I really need to do something with this animation. When there's a high energy electron, even though the high energy electron which generates this gamma cannot travel to us, or rather, it can travel to us, but we cannot say that this particular electron is coming from this supernova remnant because it will lose all of its directional information because it will travel and scattering inside the magnetic field. So even if I found one electron in the direction of supernova remnant, I cannot say that this particular electron is coming from that direction or that source because the electron can come like from my backside of my head because of the, it will bend so many times inside the magnetic field. So it will lose all of its direction. But gamma ray will not bend inside the magnetic field. So we can actually point to the source, and actually we can point to this supernova remnant and say that, oh yeah, this gamma actually is coming from this supernova remnant. And next question is, what kind of thing generates these gammas? And we can say, based on our knowledge in the interaction models, we can say, oh, there should be some high energy electron there which can generate these high energy gammas. So by understanding our environment and understanding the interactions, we can understand and actually know that about something about the cosmic rays. So that's why it's very important to actually see both pictures, not only by cosmic ray, or cosmic ray by itself is one, but also try to use the other kind of window to understand about the cosmic rays. So that's big reason why I want to talk about the electromagnetic radiation today. And we will skip this one. Okay, so that was today's lecture. And next lecture, we will talk about how quantum waves gain their energy. Because up to now, these four lectures, we continuously talk about how they will lose their energy inside the matter or inside the magnetic field. So then you like start to question yourself, like, okay, it loses its energy, that's good. Then how it gains the energy? So that, I think, is a natural question to occur. So we will talk about how quantum waves gain their energy. So, for example, this is LHC, the Large Hadron Collider, which is the most highest accelerator, highest energy of particle can be generated in this accelerator, and it has really, really large. You can see how large this is. It's like 27 kilometer long circular corner, and the annual power consumption is this much, meaning that you need to pay like $30 million per year just for the electricity, because that much is required to gain high energy, about this much. But we are dealing with quantum wave, which is somehow generating natural wave, can cover from low energy and up to really, really high energy, which this much of electricity power with humankind cannot generate. So we will talk about what kind of mechanism can generate the highest energy of quantum wave and how they can gain their energy. So that will be next lecture. Thank you for listening.